Good evening. My name is Deborah Bufton, and I am the current president of the Peace History Society, one of the co-sponsors of this conference. And I'm delighted to see you all here tonight and to welcome you to this wonderful event. And it is my distinct pleasure tonight to introduce our evening speaker. Every semester, when I begin my world history surveys to freshmen, I tell the students, most of whom are there only because the university requires them, not because they're interested in the topic. I tell my students that the value of history lies in its ability for us to see the past in such a way that we can reimagine the present and the future. And that perspective then can allow us to create a better world than the one in which we now inhabit. And this is precisely the gift that I think our speaker, Michael Kazin, brings to us tonight and has shared with the readers of many of his books, such as his biography of William Jennings Bryan, his account of the place of the political left in American history, and most relevantly to this conference, his recent study of American peace activists in World War I. Dr. Kazin is a professor of history at Georgetown University and the editor of Dissent magazine. He writes frequently for the New York Times, Foreign Affairs, The Nation, and The Daily Beast. He has written many books and has lectured widely in the United States, Europe, and Japan, and we are very lucky to have him here with us this evening. Please join me in extending a warm welcome to Professor Michael Kazin.
Thanks for that lovely introduction. And also, I was going to ask us all to applaud Andrew also for, and all the people who helped him, for putting together this really incredibly impressive and inspiring conference. So. And I have to say also that Matthew Naylor and Laura Vogt and the whole staff here, this is the best run museum I've ever been to, and that includes historical museum especially. That includes the National Museum of American History in D.C. It's really a great institution. I think, you know, I often say, I'm sure those of you World War I scholars, which I'm really not until I wrote this book at least, you always face the problem that Americans don't care that much about World War I, and we have to really make them care. But anybody comes to this museum and walks out not caring about it, had their eyes closed or was looking at their phone the whole time. So thanks again to this great museum and the people who run it and make it such a great place. Andrew asked me to use what I learned about the movement to oppose World War I in writing my book, War Against War, to reflect on opposition to war today. Opposed preparedness and the Great War, the decades that followed it, and then I'll get to the question of what the anti-war movement looks like in the present. My question is a troubling one. That is, why are the voices of war opponents so muted? The title of this conference was very well chosen, because they are muted for most Americans, at least, perhaps most Europeans, I'm not sure about that. Why do anti-militarists receive so little attention in popular narratives about armed conflicts, and, I hate to say it, among U.S. historians more generally? That's certainly true for World War I, this museum notwithstanding, but think about the National Museum of American History in Washington. I don't know how many people have seen the exhibit they have, a very large exhibit on Americans at War at the Museum of American History. They have a rather small section devoted to World War I. They have a website, of course, based on it as well. And as far as I can see, there's nothing, or almost nothing, on the movement to oppose that war. The images I got on the website, these are just a sample of them, are the kind of typical images that you see, working as a nurse, combat photos, an African-American soldier, gas masks, etc. Photos of combat, photos of pro-war figures and pro-war images generally. Nothing, or hardly anything, about the movement that was really so important in, I think, and most of us think, giving Americans an alternative way of thinking about the war, doing a lot to stall those who wanted the U.S. to get into the war, and then continuing under very serious, dangerous circumstances in opposing the war after the U.S. declares war in April 1917. And basic facts about the opposition to the war that are known to most of us today, scholars of the conflict, are pretty much unknown, I think, to most people who, even those who care about the war. How large draft resistance was, for example. How many people know, you all do, I'm sure, but how many people outside this room who know something about the war know that there are 350,000 Americans who resisted conscription. And there are 3 million Americans who never registered for the draft at all. How many know that it was the women's movement that began the mass anti-war movement, beginning with probably dating from the Women's March down Fifth Avenue, August 29th, 1914. How many people know that votes for anti-war candidates increased in the election of the fall of 1917, including a remarkable run by Morris Hillquit, the labor lawyer and socialist for the mayor of New York, where he got almost a quarter of the vote in a three-man race, running on a very explicit anti-war, anti-draft platform. How many people know about the origins of modern civil liberties jurisprudence are right there in World War I, with the beginning of the ACLU, which of course was originally the National Civil Liberties Bureau, got renamed the ACLU in 1920, and of course, with the cases that come out of the war, the Schenck case and the Abrams case and other cases in which Oliver Wendell Holmes made his famous dissent in the latter case. But there's also a good deal of ignorance and neglect about the most successful peace movement in U.S. history, that against the war in Indochina. Take, for example, the 18-hour PBS documentary, which most of you have probably seen. I heard a sigh there in the audience. Yes, 18 hours, yes. Produced by Ken Burns and Lynn Novick. Their treatment of the war itself is, in my opinion, quite splendid and appropriately negative. They made clear the U.S. was doomed to lose that war and deserved to lose that war. But when Burns and Novick turn to the subject of those who made those same arguments about the war itself, they often fall back on caricatures about millions of people, millions of protesters screaming at GIs, calling them baby killers, spitting on them, about most Americans opposed to the war, rooting for a communist victory in Vietnam. They almost entirely neglect the robust efforts that were made by groups like Vietnam Veterans Against the War to get people who were serving and had served in the military to oppose the mission that they were called upon to serve. They neglect, not entirely, but for the most part, the millions of Americans who put almost all their emphasis on the politicians who were taking America to war, continuing the disastrous intervention in Vietnam, as opposed to looking at the soldiers as their enemies, which hardly anybody really did. But perhaps we shouldn't blame the filmmakers for their flaws. After all, the United States has been at war for most of its history. There's been organized opposition to each major conflict, from the War of 1812 through the wars against Native Americans to the present. But scholarship on anti-war movements is far less known compared to that about other social movements in American history, such as those for black freedom, for women's rights, for labor organizing, and for both the grassroots left and the grassroots right. Why? That's the question I want to start my talk with. Why is the movement that we know is so important so neglected by most scholars, most textbooks as well? Some, no doubt, is due to the reverence for the military, which has always run deep in U.S. history. After all, 10 of the 40 elected U.S. presidents were elected in part, and some largely, like Eisenhower, because of their military exploits. The opponents of the other progressive movements I mentioned, and I should include the movement for LGBTQ rights, are widely viewed today as racist, sexist, homophobic, or the greedy rich, in the case of the labor movement. But for understandable reasons, neither anti-war activists nor the scholars who study them want to view ordinary combatants as the culprits behind war, even though no war can be fought without them. So it's difficult to respect their service while also explaining why and how Americans try to stop them from carrying out their mission. There's the ambiguity there, which is, I think, to a certain degree, muddies the waters for many people appreciating the scholarship. Another reason for the comparative neglect of peace movements is that they're part of a history of war and diplomacy that has long been dominated by scholars, most of them men, who focus on other matters, understanding how and why powerful men in and out of uniform made decisions to prepare for, to fight, and then negotiate an end to armed conflicts. The citizens and non-citizens who challenged their decisions seem marginal to that larger, greater history. The kind of social changes that wars often cause, or at least accelerate, also play a role in the inattention to peace activism, I think. Women's suffrage, as we know, triumphed in part as a result of the role women played in World War I, supporting the war, not opposing it. The Black Freedom Movement got a huge boost in numbers and influence as a result of World War II. The NAACP increased its membership by 1,000% during World War II. And figures like this guy, you've probably heard of, the first black man to play Major League Baseball in the 20th century, Jackie Robinson, was part of the Black Freedom Movement during the war. I don't know how many people know, but he was court-martialed during the war for refusing to get to the back of the bus at Fort Hood, Texas, a segregated state. He was found innocent of that because it was a federal base. It wasn't and a federal bus, not a state bus. It would have been found guilty probably if it was a state bus. And so he was found innocent. If he hadn't been found innocent, he would not have been the first black man to play Major League Baseball in the 20th century. There's a recent book by Walter Scheidel called The Great Leveler. Has anybody read that here? It's a fascinating book, but a troubling one too, because Scheidel argues that wars are the great leveler in human history. They sometimes promote an egalitarian communal spirit, which helps to narrow the income gap between the rich and everyone else. Sometimes they just destroy everything in their path, including the property of the rich as well as the property of the poor. So everybody ends up poor, and that helps level things as well. But nevertheless, there's a way in which war has, he argues, and it's perhaps debatable, but it's a powerful argument he makes, has been responsible for a movement towards a more egalitarian social policy in history. But I think the very nature of anti-war movements plays a part in this neglect as well. Anti-war movements, if you think about them, are not like other collective attempts to change society. In contrast to those who seek rights and a measure of power for women or workers or people of color or gays and lesbians, peace organizers have no natural constituency, unless it's everybody, which is obviously not the same thing as having a specific constituency demographically or otherwise. Neither can their movement grow slowly, taking decades to convince ordinary people and elites to think differently and to enact laws to embody that new perspective, the way these other movements can do it. The Black Freedom Movement, for example, one can argue began during slavery, creative, like a huge war against war exhibit in Brooklyn and New York City that featured witty cartoons, featured a scale model of a papier-mâché model of a stegosaurus with the caption, he went extinct because he had he had armor plate but no brains. And hundreds of thousands of people visited that exhibit in 1916 in New York. And of course, as most of you know, their last important tactic was to try to win that referendum, if in fact it had been held. But of course, they were unable to convince the president and Congress to keep the nation at peace. Yet their legacy is not simply one of failure. They warned credibly about the consequences of American intervention and were transformed, I think, by the late 1920s from traitors into something akin to prophets. Senator William Stone, the chair of the Foreign Relations Committee, a Democrat from Missouri, who was one of the six senators to vote against the declaration of war, even though it was being called for by the president of his own party, said this in his speech. "I won't vote for war because if we go into it, we'll never again have the same old republic." This can be read in many different ways. It can be read as a reactionary statement. It can be read as a statement by somebody who wanted to continue on the kind of progress the old republic was already making. But it was clearly, in many ways, I think, accurate whether the old republic was a good one or not. Because we now realize that the anti-militarists had made a mighty attempt to prevent the establishment of a political order most Americans now, unfortunately, take for granted, even if some protested, like most of us here. That is, a state equipped to fight numerous wars abroad while keeping a close watch on the potentially subversive activities of its citizens at home. The warfare state, the national security state, the surveillance state, call it what you will. The identity of the nation's enemies has changed often over the past century, but the stated purpose of American foreign policy has nearly always remained the same: to create a world, as Wilson said, made safe for democracy. Now, Donald Trump has abandoned that idealistic rhetoric, only to replace it with a different kind of, perhaps, curdled idealism, an aggressive ethno-nationalism that aims to put America first and to force every other country to surrender to its whims. Yet soon after the Great War ended, its foes in the United States did begin to experience a kind of redemption. The former allies refused to pay back their war loans to the U.S. European nations again fell into bitter quarrels and internal strife and revolution. And Americans increasingly viewed peace advocates as more prophetic than disloyal. In 1922, Robert La Follette, senator from Wisconsin, one of the six senators to vote against the war, who was almost expelled from the Senate for his opposition to the war during the war itself, was reelected to the Senate by the large majority in Wisconsin history. Led by Jane Addams and Emily Balch, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, the successor to the Women's Peace Party, gained thousands of members during the 20s, both in the United States and abroad, with a really radical platform that called for complete pacifism and opposition to imperialism. In 1922, Jane Addams asked, "Was not war in the interest of democracy for the salvation of civilization a contradiction in terms? Whoever said it, and however often it was repeated?" Most Americans, probably a few years after that, would have responded in the affirmative. They would have agreed with her about that. 1931, as most of you know, Jane Addams won the Nobel Peace Prize. The committee in Norway saluted her for, in effect, being right all along. The quote from the statement, "She held fast to the ideal of peace even during the difficult hours when other considerations and interests obscured it from her compatriots and drove them into the conflict." Couldn't get a much clearer statement about how she was right and Wilson and all those who supported him were wrong. The New York Times, which was not as liberal a paper as it often is today, and had excoriated Addams during the war for her pacifism, now hoped that her wartime prophecy of international cooperation might be coming true. At the time, most Americans also looked back on the conflict with retrospective regret. The number of war commemorations dwindled rapidly. Construction of the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier at Arlington National Cemetery was delayed for 5 years, as officials argued about whether it should symbolize war or peace. Sorry, I missed the graphic, Jane. This was shown by somebody else earlier. This is a photo, as many of you know, showing the American delegation to the Women's Conference for Peace in The Hague in 1915. And of course, Jane Addams is there, first from the your left. 1929, the Senate approved with one dissenting vote the Quai-Bouillon Treaty, that grand, if unenforceable, treaty to outlaw war. And 60 nations signed it by year's end. 1934, a special Senate committee, chaired by Gerald Nye of North Dakota, began to investigate the charge that munitions producers had dragged the nation into the Great War. They never uncovered a conspiracy. Most conspiratorial theories of history never quite pan out. But their well-publicized hearings persuaded many Americans that, as Nye put it, quote, "War and preparation for war is not a matter of national honor and national defense, but a matter of profit for the few." And popular histories written at the same time took a sharply negative view of U.S. intervention as well, even though they didn't always agree with Nye's economic analysis of the war. Revisionist accounts of the Great War sold very well. The great American historian Charles Beard wrote one of them. The best-selling of those books was Walter Millis's The Road to War, America 1914-1917, high up in the bestseller list for many months. And popular opinion was both helping these books to sell well and was, of course, reflected by their point of view as well. In 1937, the Gallup poll found that 70% of American respondents believed it had been a mistake for the United States to fight the Great War. 70%. In each of the previous years, Congress, by overwhelming majorities, had voted for neutrality acts, which essentially took the same actions the Peace Coalition had demanded 20 years before. An embargo on selling arms or loaning money to belligerents, and a prohibition on Americans traveling on the ships of belligerent nations. Of course, the war hadn't begun yet, so at least not a world war. In 1937, lawmakers overwhelmingly again also slapped a ban on U.S. vessels carrying either people or materiel to any nation at war. In other polls, opinion polls, large majorities of Americans supported a constitutional amendment that would require a popular referendum before the U.S. could go to war. It was sponsored by this man, Representative Lewis Ludlow, a Democrat of Indiana. And President Franklin Roosevelt was so afraid that this amendment would pass, and he was a Wilsonian, of course, he was opposed to this kind of restriction on the war powers, that Democratic leaders in Congress, pushed by Roosevelt, made sure the amendment never got to the floor of Congress to be debated, because they were afraid if it got debated, then Americans might actually support it, and then it might actually get enacted, at least passed by Congress. Robert La Follette had written to his son-in-law as the First World War was ending, "I may not live to see my own vindication, but you will." He died in 1925, and he didn't. But 20 years after the war ended, he seemed correct. However, another war happened. And most scholars and politicians who had made these anti-war arguments and had redeemed the anti-war movement during the war repudiated that opinion after the attack on Pearl Harbor, if they hadn't after the German and Soviet invasions of Poland in 1939. Great War revisionism fell out of favor and even appeared deeply unpatriotic. In the wake by Samuel Eliot Morrison and Henry Still Commager, two of the leading historians of that time, a little more than 50 years ago. And this is how they wrote about Wilson's decision to go to war. They compared it to Abraham Lincoln's decision during the secession winter of 1861 to try to reinforce the garrison at Fort Sumter, actually the spring of 61. They said, this is in my textbook, high school textbook, "President Wilson felt the lesser evil was for America to join the conflict, to try to direct the peace that must eventually come into channels that would justify the sacrifice." They concluded, "Few would doubt now that he was right." Then came another war, the debacle in Indochina. In justifying the intervention against an enemy force led by communists, President Lyndon Baines Johnson sounded eerily like Woodrow Wilson in his speeches calling for peace without victory, in his speech calling for a declaration of war, and then in some ways also his 14-point speech. In a speech he gave at Johns Hopkins University in April 1965, he said, we want a peace without conquest in Vietnam. Peace without victory, peace without conquest, there's really no difference. "We fight because we must fight," said LBJ, "if we are to live in a world where every country can shape its own destiny, clothing an imperial adventure in the language of civic virtue." Prominent, now elderly men and women who had vigorously opposed U.S. intervention in the Great War were still around during the Vietnam War to reprise their youthful performances. Norman Thomas, A. Philip Randolph, delivered rousing speeches against the bloodshed in Indochina. A.J. Mustie, who Layla Danielson has written a wonderful book about, organized seminarians to burn their draft cards. At the age of 87, Jeanette Rankin, here she is in 1932, opposing the war. here she is at 87, led an eponymous brigade of about 3,000 women in a 1968 march to the Capitol building in D.C., where they delivered a petition against, quote, the ruthless slaughter in Vietnam to the Speaker of the House. Who was the Speaker of the House? John McCormick, a veteran of World War I. So 50 years seemed very short to both Jeanette Rankin and John McCormick at that moment, I think. In another echo of the war, the anti-war movement during the Great War, there was a very popular 1970 soul record that shot to number one on the Billboard chart by Edwin Starr. Some of you of a certain age might remember it. It posed the rhetorical question, war, what is it good for? Jane Addams and her sisters in the Women's Peace Party would have applauded the answer. It means destruction of innocent lives. War means tears to thousands of mothers' eyes when their sons go off to fight and lose their lives. War, what is it good for? Absolutely nothing. Thank you. Boy, what a treat. Anyway, echoes of World War I could also be heard in soldiers' accounts of the war in Vietnam. Several years after Americans left Vietnam in defeat, Philip Caputo was struggling to finish a memoir he wrote, which became a bestseller, about the wrenching year he spent as a Marine in that country. He said he, quote, fell under the spell of the great British memoirs from World War I by Siegfried Sassoon and other veterans of the Great War. Quote, the form somehow felt right. It seemed to me that Vietnam, though a far less bloody and horrible conflict, resembled the First World War in its pointlessness, its ultimate disillusionment, and the changes it wrought in cultural and social values. And we still live in the shadow of the Vietnam War, too, 50 years later, I think, as Americans during the Vietnam War lived in the shadow of World War I. One of the changes the U.S. defeat in Vietnam helped bring about, as World War I brought about, at least for a time, until 1939, was a reluctance on the part of most Americans to hurl what remains the world's most potent military machine into what are allegedly world-saving wars. Now, popular majorities, as we know, of Americans did support the invasions of Afghanistan in 2001 and of Iraq in 2003. But most did so to revenge the terrorist atrocities of 9/11 and prevent new ones, not because President George W. Bush assured U.S. troops, quote, the peace of a troubled world, the hopes of an oppressed people now depend on you. Again, sounding very Wilsonian. And long before those interventions stretched into a second decade, and now the one in Afghanistan looks like it'll stretch into a third and fourth decade, Americans, most of them at least, had grown cynical about the mission while honoring the men and women in uniform still struggling to complete it. But the question again, to bring it forward now, is why is there no large or visible anti-war movement to oppose those involvements, as there was at least briefly before the invasion of Iraq 14 years ago, and there clearly was during World War I, and clearly was during the Vietnam War. Why is that? Sadly, the last national anti-war demonstration, at least the last one I know about, took place about 2.5 years ago in Washington, D.C. Here's a photo from it. Maybe some of you were there. It was called the Spring Rising Anti-War Intervention. It attracted about 500 demonstrators, received no coverage at all in the mainstream media, and not even much mention in left-wing outlets like the magazine I edit, Dissent. So why is this? That's the question I want to pose for us. The most obvious, the most significant one, perhaps, is the nature of the enemies the United States has been fighting since the fall of 2001. There are, of course, many distinctions between al-Qaeda and the Taliban, Saddam Hussein's regime, in retrospect, and ISIS. But nearly all Americans, I think sensibly, regard each of these groups with loathing. So most anti-war activists instead, and many of you in this room probably do too, have sort of shifted the focus to focus on innocent victims of the interventions, how U.S. military actions kill and maim large numbers of civilians, particularly with drones, sometimes directed from buildings located about 10 miles from where I live in Northern Virginia. But compared to the Vietnam War, this is also a different movement, and for some of the reasons I want to suggest. The anti-war movement in Vietnam did not come out of nowhere. No movement ever does. We historians know that. There's always antecedents. There's always reasons why people join a movement that have to do with who they are and what they're engaged in and what they care about before they join that movement. And many of the most talented and committed activists during the Vietnam War against it came from other movements on the broad left, against poverty, for civil liberties, for nuclear disarmament, and especially for black liberation. Feminism came a little bit later, to the late 60s. All had learned before the Vietnam War ever came into their sights to define their politics as a moral undertaking that could transform the world. They were optimistic internationalists. There were slogans like SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee's slogan, "One Man, One Vote, Mississippi, Vietnam." Muhammad Ali's famous statement, "I ain't got no quarrel with them Viet Cong, no Viet Cong ever called me nigger," when he applied to be a conscientious objector, unsuccessfully. The link between the black freedom movement and the anti-war movements especially was very tight and very close.
For both,
excuse me? I'm sorry, I can't. Yes, I know, I know. Yeah, it's successful, I know, but at first, you're right, correct, sorry. He applied at first unsuccessfully. So for both groups, both black activists and anti-war activists, and those who became both, and those who supported, white people supported the first one, and then got active in the second one, they were passionate internationalists. Even if they didn't, you know, support the Viet Cong, I think, you know, a majority of Americans who opposed the war did not, nevertheless, they saw a sense that this peasant army was at least to be sympathized with. Quite different from saying, well, Taliban, Al-Qaeda are hardly groups that support gender equality or anything else that those who are in progressive movements hold dear. Black Lives Matter is certainly opposed, wants to cut down the military budget, but, you know, pulling troops out of Afghanistan and stopping American advisors from going to Iraq is not one of their priorities. So current anti-activists, again, anti-war activists then, like many of us in the room, face a very difficult obstacle, a very high obstacle. Few Americans share our moral urgency to oppose current armed interventions abroad. And one reason, perhaps, is why few progressives are spending their time in the anti-war cause today is that the issue is not the property of progressives and the left alone, as for the most part, the movement against the war in Vietnam was. This guy, senator from Kentucky, Rand Paul, is in many ways just as articulate and principled an opponent of surveillance state as anybody on the left is. You probably know the website antiwar.com, and it regularly publishes articles from the left and from the right and from the center. So that could be a plus, but it's also difficult to define, you know, then what your community is if you're in the anti-war movement, I think. He speaks out, does Paul, against imperial overreach. He speaks out as against NSA surveillance. And even Donald Trump, I'm not saying a good word for Donald Trump here. I'm putting him in context. Donald Trump sometimes echoes the views, at least through the campaign, of people like Rand Paul. After all, if you say America first, that can be taken in different ways, but one of the ways it can be taken is, let's not worry about intervening in the rest of the world. Let's just worry about our cultivating our own garden. That's not, of course, how he's governing at all, but that was the slogan. I think that's one of the reasons he appealed to people. And here's Randolph Byrne. One of the most eloquent foes of the war, as most of you know. He gave the same explanation for why he opposed the war and what he thought Americans should do who did oppose the war. He said in late 1917 in the great essay, A War Diary, "If America has lost its political isolation, it's all the more obligated to retain its spiritual integrity. This does not mean any smug retreat from the world with a belief that the truth is in us and can only be contaminated by contact. It means that the promise of American life is not yet achieved, perhaps not even seen, and that until it is, there's nothing for us but stern and intensive cultivation of our garden. So we Americans honor the troops over and over again in public venues, from ballparks to airports, even though we're dubious at best about the wars they're fighting in Afghanistan and Iraq and oppose the idea of further conflicts with Iran or North Korea. Anti-war activists then struggle with this contradiction. The public is skeptical about U.S. military intervention, but does not see it as a threat to any interest or ideal they hold dear. And that is your and our task, is to convince them that it does. To conclude with not my own words, but the words of the philosopher William James, who I began and ended my book with, and I got the title of my book, War Against War, as many of you, might know, not from reading my book, but from reading William James, the first line of his great complex essay, A Moral Equivalent of War, which I'm going to assume you've all read. The first line goes, "The war against war is going to be no holiday excursion or camping party." He didn't know the half of it. Writing in 1910, right before he died, James could not have foreseen the horrors that the next century of wars would produce. But he brilliantly examined how organized killing could take on the allure of selfless service for one's fellow citizens, even for humanity as a whole. But James thought it was growing more difficult for, quote, civilized man, as he put it, to justify it. Pure loot and mastery seemed no longer morally allowable motives, he wrote. Pretexts must be found for attributing them solely to the enemy. No legitimate interest of any European nation, he said, would seem to justify the tremendous destructions which a war would necessarily entail. Common sense and reason ought to find a way to reach agreement in every conflict of honest interests. This is a true progressive mind at work there. There's nothing that honest men, and he should have added women, could not do if we come together and study a problem and figure out how to work our way through it. It's a wonderful, if naive, belief. I wish we could live like that. I wish we did live like that. But sadly, what James considered legitimate, honest, and reasonable had little bearing on how nations, then or now, go to war or why their citizens take part in them. Most of the wars the United States has fought over the past two centuries have been no less optional, no less wars of choice than World War I. The conflict with Mexico in the 1840s, which was mostly a land grab, the war with Spain in 1898, which ended up being a land grab, the Korean police action during the early 1950s, the Indochina ordeal of the 1960s and 70s, and the recent invasions and occupations of Afghanistan and Iraq were all wars of choice. Oh, one could argue in the case of Korea that the choice to fight North Korea did save half that nation from a future of tyranny and hunger. In U.S. history, only the Second World War stands out as an unavoidable conflict in which Americans are arguably fighting for national survival instead of just exercising a strategic or a moral option. The outsized place that World War II holds in our historical memory thus gives Americans what the historian Jonathan Ebel says is a narrative of military triumph without a cautionary narrative to leaven it. William James would have appreciated, I think, the idea that one good war, particularly when it was the biggest and most destructive war in human history, bestows a respect and honor on soldiering that no other occupation really enjoys. In 1910, he bemoaned the fact that, quote, "the military, patriotic, and the romantic-minded everywhere, and especially the professional military class, refused to admit for a moment that war may be a transitory phenomenon in social evolution." Isn't that wonderful? A transitory phenomenon in social evolution. Sadly, it remains true that most people cannot consider that possibility. To reverse that, to begin to change not just scholarship but history, we might learn more and, I think, tell our students and our fellow citizens more about the movement that we're focusing on at this conference. The movement that fought so zealously and diligently against the Great War, knowing what a failure to halt it short of victory for one side might mean. They were pacifists and socialists, they were anarchists and feminists and white supremacists, they were Democrats and Republicans, black and white, Protestants, Catholics, Jews, Eastern Orthodox. They had no illusion they could achieve their purpose by staying aloof from the rest of the world. They were not isolationists. They made alliances in practice and sympathy with their counterparts in Europe and elsewhere in the world. They argued passionately and consistently that a durable peace depended on the United States forging a tolerant, non-aggressive relationship with other nations, one based not on preparing for war, but on avoiding it. Perhaps we should thank them for their service too. Sadly, a moral equivalent of war seems more elusive now than it was when James explained why it was both difficult and imperative. There's a grim judgment, a very short judgment in that essay, if you remember it, which keeps haunting me. James wrote, "History is a bath of blood." Only when we recognize that and arm ourselves with alternatives, both pragmatic and visionary and educational and scholarly, may we be able someday to change it. Thank you.
Again, ladies and gentlemen, I believe that Michael Kazin is willing to take some question and answer. You'll notice that there are some lovely and well-lit microphones on either side.
And thanks for the factual correction, too.
And we would love to get your questions on the microphones. And I've heard some really delightful discussions today, so I know that there might be some wonderful questions at hand. And the first will come from this side.
Thank you for a very fine talk. Lots of good and useful stuff. I'd like to suggest you might add to your list of answers to the very important question you
started. I'm not sure they can hear you.
Closer to the microphone.
Got it.
Thank you for a fine talk. If you would consider adding to your list of possible answers to the great question you started with, why is there no anti-war movement now? Consider who ended the draft? Richard M. Nixon. And he did so cynically, predicting and knowing that the anti-war movement against his war would stop. Within months, demonstrations disappeared. And it wasn't just students, it was their parents, largely middle class, who had some real clout with Congress, who stopped lobbying. So I think that's at least one of the things that could answer the question you posed.
I mean, it's certainly true if there were a draft today, there'd be more resistance. But remember, the draft ended, it was 1973, and by that time, all American combat troops were already out of Vietnam, and the POWs were coming home, like John McCain. So, given the fact that U.S. combat troops were not there anymore fighting, the anti-war movement would have declined anyway. You have to get people already care about that issue. I mean, in some ways, this is not so different from climate change, I hate to say it, as someone who understands climate change is such a dire threat to the future of the world, as wars are. That's a very tough issue to get massive people behind, but at least they can see, the damage that is done by hurricanes and the Miami Beach getting flooded and this kind of thing. So it's, I'm all in favor of gestures like that. I'm just not sure, unfortunately, they're going to be very successful.
But I don't think that people should stop and start and stop and start depending on the crisis and the issue. I think, people know nuclear weapons can eradicate all life, and militarism steals, from the hungry.
I agree.
Thank you.
All I can do is analyze why they're not. I share your feelings. I mean, the first political act I ever did was I went to a meeting in Madison Square Garden in New York, a Ban the Bomb rally, which was sponsored by, I think, Committee for Sane Nuclear Policy, and Dr. Spock was the main speaker with my mother, and I was 7 years old, 8 years old. So, and I wore a little C&D button, throughout high school, when my fellow students called me a commie, so for doing it. So.
Our next question will come from this side of the auditorium.
So you're analyzing why there's not as much of an anti-war movement presently. I'm wondering whether you could comment on whether the Obama victory in 2008 in some fashion is a culmination of that anti-war movement. He came to prominence, he came to prominence on the 2004 convention, but he came to prominence as an anti-war
right.
Spokesperson. I think he won the primaries, I think primarily because of being his vote against, well, he didn't vote, but her vote in favor, his vote opposed. So could we claim victory? And then that raises the other question. Once we claim victory, how do we evaluate his his presidency with regard to war and peace?
That's a great question. No, that's a good point. I mean, I think also John Kerry, you know, ran on pulling out of Iraq in 2004, and you know, he didn't win, but of course got votes from people who agreed with him about that. I'm sorry?
He voted for the war.
Yeah. But he turned against it by 2004.
If you missed it, he just said he voted for the war.
Yeah, true. Obama didn't have a chance to vote for the war. He wasn't in Congress. But it's a good point. I mean, I think that the problem, of course, is once he got elected, then people said, okay, you know, that's done, and people stopped pushing. And of course, he did begin to pull troops out of Afghanistan and Iraq, and that was positive. But U.S. support still went on, and of course, now we're going to have more troops in Afghanistan. I just, you know, I think, and this is, I think, generally true in the politics of most democratic nations, you need an inside-outside strategy, you know. You can't depend on the Democratic Party, or certainly the Republican Party right now, at least, to make peace, to move towards peace. You need an independent movement to push them. And same time, you can't just have the independent movement, because people in power got to make the decisions to go to war, to pull the troops out, to limit the military budget if they will. Under Obama, you know, what people cared about was the Great Recession, right? What they cared about was whether the ACA was going to pass or not. The wars were there, he gave speeches about them, but they were way down on the priorities of most people, even most progressives, you know, which is, as I was mentioning. So, yes, you're right, that was successful, the anti-war movement, but I think the fact that American troop strength has gone down in those countries, you know, is also a success in a way, but it's, there's no fundamental questioning, I think, of the strategy of why you know, terrorism, you know, does spread up around the world, why there's so many angry young people in these countries. You know, that's not the kind of question that perhaps policymakers are equipped to answer, but nevertheless, the question that if we could care about peace in the world, we have to be responding to. The other question was, the second part of the question, I forget. Yeah, what he does. Yeah, he does. Yeah, well, I answered some of that then, I guess, you know. You know, I think Obama, you know, we could have an argument about this. I'm more favorable to his foreign policy than some people are, not because it's what I would have wanted, but I think given the pressures on him from the military, from the Republicans, from other issues, I'm not sure he deserved the Nobel Peace Prize a year into his presidency, but or less than a year into his presidency, but I think his opening to Cuba, I think, is a major act, which now Trump's trying to take back. I think that he, you know, attempted to put the relationship with Iran on a more rational basis, of course, with the peace treaty. So, you know, I think given what he inherited, given the military he inherited, given the fact that, you know, he's got to get reelected, all these things, I think he probably did about it as good as he could have, especially given the fact most Americans didn't care that much, as I said, about what he was doing in Afghanistan and Iraq, unless they were there, unless they had family there, and that is partly a result of the draft, I guess. The lack of a draft.
Now, I know that there are more questions, and I believe that Michael will be here tomorrow as well.
No.
No, so stay late and ask him those questions.
I'd like to come, but I've got a family wedding I've got to go back for. So.
All right, so don't miss your chance. Now you have it. And please be sure to ask all of the rest of those follow-up questions right now. Please join me in thanking Michael Kazin.
Thank you.